move on to another match, also with Gafriel. This one's going to be, oh, on Skyring Knight. This should be interesting. So, Wildebeest as Paloma with Gafriel as Baco, which is actually Gafriel's main, against Jin as Pestilus and Innocence as Jumong. Inoxence. Yeah, I like that one. So, Best and Jumong versus Paloma and Baco, which is kind of bizarre. Let's think about this for a second. So, Pestilence and Jumong, definitely going to be kind of out of the way. They're going to be worrying mostly about Gafriel being aggressive with Baco. But then again, Baco doesn't have to be aggressive. This could, especially on Skyring Knight, end up being a relatively range-focused match. Like, just Blood Axes being thrown about as Wildebeest tends to just throw out Wolves and Inoxence and Jin just hanging out from a distance. And he actually already getting the Blood Axe Snare as well, so Gafriel and Wildebeest are definitely set up for more ranged fight. There's the opening Blood Axe, and Bulwark's coming in there, so it looks like Gafriel is going to be fairly aggressive, not overly aggressive, not committing too hard. There's the fight on Jin. They wanted to go for that. You want to focus down Pestilus, or at least that's the general consensus, is to focus down Pestilus, take them out, because Pestilus can have a hard time defending themselves, but against a good Pestilus, that's very difficult to pull off. Good Pestiluses tend to be very good at keeping enemies away, very good at knowing when to use Infest and to what. And especially if they have the Queen Panic right, which this one doesn't, but even then, they can use that as well. Just getting away from your opponent is something a good Pestilus will do beautifully, and focusing them down becomes almost impossible. At this point, almost no damage has been dealt to the red team. Gafriel's taken loads of damage. Wildebeest has taken some permanent damage as well. And neither opponent has been focused on. Finally, some permanent health being taken away from Inoxence. And Inoxence being pulled away from their Pestilus, from their healer, actually taking some meaningful damage, trying to get that Seeker's Mark material off. Does manage to Black Arrow away from that shot. That was close, though. Black Arrowing away from the Heroic Charge. Pretty much what they needed to survive. If that Heroic Charge had hit, they would have been focused down entirely and probably torn up in about 2 seconds. And even as it is, they're taking a lot of damage. But blue team having taken more. Wildebeest taking quite a bit of damage. Managing to heal themselves fairly effectively. And there's attempt to Scarab. Attempt to Reflect the Scarab, which actually did succeed. Damaging Jin a little bit. And the center being taken by, well, I mean, really, Gafriel and Wildebeest have taken every single orb. They've taken 4 orbs so far, and they've needed them. With Gafriel moving fairly forward, and yeah, they are using fairly intelligent uses of their Blood Axes. I mean, that is the right call. It's just they need to rush in and be melee, and it's difficult to get in with that. And they end up leaping in, and that's difficult to work with. And down goes their teammate as well. Wildebeest finally falling. Having been separated from Gafriel, that was not ideal, but at this point, just Gafriel's desperately trying to go for something. The Bulwark's doing an okay job. It's just very difficult when you consider just how little they can poke. Like, Jumong has great poking ability, and Baco doesn't. Baco has good poking ability. Don't get me wrong, Blood Axe is quite effective. But compared to Jumong's 14 damage every second or so, or 15 damage every second or so, from their arrows, it's just no comparison. So at this point, Wildebeest and Gafriel have got to be a bit more careful. I almost wonder if Wildebeest should be rushing in a little bit as well, just to try to panic. Like, knock Inoxence away by getting close enough, throwing off panics, but that'd be very difficult, though. Like, Inoxence is, they're Black Arrowing, they're Prowling, they're doing everything they need to, well, not Prowling, Predationing. Everything they need to do to avoid getting hit, to avoid their opponents, and it's working out fairly effectively. At this point, pokes continuing to come out, both players just waiting until the orb comes down. Now the orb finally down, looks like blue team gonna get it again. And no real poking managing to get in. There's an attempt at poking, but not enough, I'm afraid. However, oh, nice! Oh, this is perfect for blue team, as Jin got way out of position. Had infested their teammate, though, but still got very much out of position. And is that a war shout just to get away from incapacitate? That was very nicely timed. Beautifully timed from Gabriel. And there's the ultimate. Trying to get rid of Jin. Jin almost down. And at the same time, Wildebeest also almost down. Other side of themselves to save their own lives. But Jin looks like they're going to go down first. One good shot. Any good shot will work. And very nice soul transfer. Wildebeest getting themselves soul transferred into a proper position. But at this point, though, both Wildebeest and Jin are roughly the same health. Wildebeest with a bit more permanent health for them. And nice Spirit Rift. Healing themselves up a little bit as well. What you want to do. It's EX Soul Drain, but it heals you automatically. However, Paloma's still going down, but with the 1v1, Baco versus Jumong. It was Baco versus Jade. I call it for Jade. But Baco versus Jumong. Bit less crowd control that Jumong has. And there's the ultimate. Ow! Missing the ultimate. Bit too far of range. Inoxen's able to avoid that just by walking out of the way. And there's the predation into the incapacitate. And still apparently just enough crowd control that it is still a massive difficulty for Baco to deal with this. And time in the war shout just to avoid that arrow. But one more shot, there's the shot. I was thinking one more shot would do it. And indeed it does. As Inoxen wins it for the red team. So red team with 2 matches to blue team's 0. Clearly a little bit more coordinated on the red side. I mean, the thing is when Wildebeest, basically when Jin got knocked away, Wildebeest also got knocked away, which meant basically they were kind of in the same position. No real momentum was gained, which kind of sucks because if Jin goes down, if either healer goes down, it's a big deal. One shot will do. But on the other hand, Wildebeest does have the possibility of using their... Well, I guess soul transfer to some. Actually, soul transfer is quite handy. To some extent, Spirit Guide would also be handy. I mean, Spirit Guide into Spirit Rift, but it's a little bit... Soul Drain is the EX version of Spirit Rift. My mistake. Oh, that backwards. But yeah, Soul Drain or Spirit Rift. Throwing that in after some delay after a Spirit Guide, because it'd be too predictable otherwise. That could work. And there's the Spirit Guide, and there it is! But it is a bit too predictable. Did not wait on that one. If that was Soul Drain, I would have totally agreed because it would have at least gotten some health. Like, it would have dealt some damage. But unfortunately, it didn't manage on its own. And this is where another Soul Transfer would be awesome. Throwing down the Ancestral Spirit for, you know, nothing else, some healing. But yeah, that's where... Oh, this is where Soul Transfer would be perfect. They have Soul Transfer. They don't have the meter for it. And unfortunately, Capriol missing again with the Heroic Charge. That's second time this match that they've missed with that. Which is unfortunate. Yeah, if Wildebeest... Okay, there's the soul transfer. Well, yeah, there it is, soul transfer. But not quite the timing I meant. That was like 10 seconds ago. Not now. Cavriel with a bit of damage coming in there. And the focus... Actually, quite a lot of focus from Wildebeest onto Inoxen. Wildebeest doing a pretty good job holding their own in this round. Actually, quite a bit of a better job almost. Cavriel taking a fair amount of damage, but that's fine. Wildebeest is the healer, so they should be the one at slightly higher health. In a slightly safer position, because, you know, they're the ones actually keeping their teammate alive. At any rate, Inoxen's also in a bit of a tricky position. Cavriel, however, with more absolute health than either Inoxen's or Jin. And Jin getting most of the focus here. The infest onto the queen, basically allowing for Inoxen's to die as Jin removes themselves from the fight. And Scarab coming out here for Jin. Where's the Bulwark? There's the Bulwark! It was bound to come out at some point. And there's the win for Cavriel and Wildebeest. A fairly convincing win too, I might add. Nicely done, you two. So blue team gets on the board. That was the one thing, though, is that it was a matter of whether or not Cavriel and Wildebeest were able to focus in without losing their own position. Which they did manage to do so that time. They didn't manage to do so as much the previous time. That match worked out quite well, though. So, now I'm curious what Jin and Inoxen are going to do to try to adapt to that. I mean, going hardcore for the zoning game, and actually pretty hardcore for the Capriol focus game, which might be a bit of a mistake. Okay, now we're into two 1v1s. This happened last time, and actually, Wildebeest did a pretty good job of holding their own last time it happened as well. And there's the soul transfer for the extra health and wildebeest, while Cavriel doing fine, dealing a lot of damage to Jin as Jin pulls himself out of the fight. And that is one of the tricky things with infest. If you hit something and don't infest out of it, yeah, you don't get hit, but you're out of the fight and your teammate can't be healed. Which is actually pretty much what won the match last round. And this round, it might come in as well. Another separation once again. Do have Cavriel going after Wildebeest, and Inoxens is trying to help out. Another great soul transfer from Wildebeest did manage to save this. Sorry, Cavriel going after Jin, but continuing to go after Jin, and Wildebeest taking a chunk of damage from that Dragon Slayer, forcing them somewhat out of the fight. Cavriel still manages to hold their own moderately well, but Wildebeest needs to get healed up, getting the kill, walking the Ancestral Spirit. There you go. Wildebeest able to get their health back up to a reasonable-ish 66. Team healths are just about even. But, of course, you don't deal less damage as you take more damage, so advantage definitely goes to the blue team. Oh, perfectly timed predation there from Inoxens. I mean, they really are trying to play the avoidance game and not able to do so fully successfully, allowing Cavriel and Wildebeest to get back on the board. And it looked like there was just a positioning issue at the very end there. Just Inoxens walked, basically they black arrowed right into their opponents rather than black arrowing away. And, well, that had rather predictable results. So last round, Wildebeest and Cavriel getting their momentum going. Jin and Inoxens still holding their own pretty well, holding the fight fairly well. I'm sure they're going to expect Cavriel coming in, and Inoxens, are they going to go for Wildebeest again? Because it happened the first time, round two, it worked out fairly well, but round three and round four, that's backfired. And Inoxens not helping out Jin has pretty much led to their downfall. So the question now is going to be, if Cavriel goes after Jin once again, which they likely will Inoxens help out their teammate, or will they try to essentially do the same thing on the other side? And now we're going to find out. Jin infesting their teammate. Jin infesting Inoxens and does manage to get out of it into a pretty safe position. Not safe enough, though, across the other side of the wall, and Inoxens is indeed trying to help out, trying to deal with Cavriel as best as they can. But it's just not enough, as Inoxens, they're not taking a huge amount of damage, but there's the, oh, missing with the main shot, but hitting with the splash damage on the ultimate. Managing to get a bit of damage on Jin, and that bulwark. Beautiful bulwark play from Cavriel, by the way. But yeah, Jin taking a decent amount of damage. Wildebeest, however, taking the front lines. Bako going for the Jin, and Inoxens is going to help out their teammate. They're not trying to kill Wildebeest anymore. They are trying to keep Jin safe. That is Inoxens' strategy, and Jin stuck in the middle of the Ancestral Spirit, taking all the damage, getting rooted and dead. And Bulwark the Dragon Slayer, that is the most perfect thing that could happen to the blue team right now. Getting a kill and getting an ultimate reflected onto your opponent. I think it's fully charged Dragon Slayer too, or very close. And there's the Ancestral Spirit to not quite win, but just about force a win. Well, force position change into the heroic charge, into a bad position that gave the win for Cavriel and Wildebeest. Total run back. Nicely done with the run back. Those are always entertaining to watch. Anyway, that was a good example of tactics. Really what it came down to is that red team had this tactical idea of how to approach the fight, which did work for a while until Wildebeest and Cavriel became a bit more concerned about staying together. And Wildebeest got a little bit more aggressive, which paid off very well. And it won them the match. So Jin and Inoxens did a fine job too. It's just, it's always hard to know when you're dealing with this situation of this split 1v1, especially when it's a non-support versus support. It's clear that one team is trying to kill your support. Do you go after that person trying to kill your support, or do you go after their support? If you go after their support and their support's not great at defending themselves, it can work out, as we saw in round two. But if their support is... Yeah, that was round two. If their support is, however, able to sustain themselves, then it's not quite as effective. And we actually saw Jin doing a fine job getting out of trouble as well. It was very difficult for Cavriel and Wildebeest to pin down Jin. And similarly, very difficult for Inoxens after that second round to pin down Wildebeest. So it really just came down to taking advantage of very slight points where there's a tiny advantage and then exploding that. Like, just locking your opponent down and tearing them to shreds. Anyhow, this last match is going to be between Pharos and a bunch of other people. So another one with Pharos. And if you guys want to have your matches on here as well, just post them to the Odium and let me know. I mean, now that the Odium actually allows me to spectate properly, or at least as well as replays will, you might as well just let me know, hey, this is a thing. I've got a replay. Go and watch it. I want your commentary. And if you want that, just let me know. Just tell me your battle right name and maybe tell me the name of the replay you want to have casted. And yeah, I'd love to. It'd be awesome. So yeah, it's much easier than it was before. We had to send replay files and all that. So yeah, thanks to Unlock Studios for making the Odium that much better. Or at least on par with the replay system, which has its own issues, but is at least functional for this purpose. Anyway, Pharos and as older against Ethelwulf as Croak. Or with Ethelwulf as Croak, rather. Against Fatal as Varesh and Flexi as Pestilus. So another Pestilus and another Varesh as well. And we don't have Pharos on the Croak. We do have another Varesh focus from the Croak player, from Ethelwulf. And this time, though, of course, there isn't the situation where you only have one team with a support. Both teams have supports. So it's a very different situation. However, oh my goodness, that was interesting. That Wuju just coming in there, hitting Pharos because the reflection from Chronoflux, like it was Hand of Judgment reflected by Chronoflux, hitting the Wuju of Fatal and then causing Fatal to counter against Pharos because it counted as Pharos' attack, but then out of position, which was the main problem as Fatal, thankfully didn't take too much damage from that, but is taking a lot of damage from being in the center away from their healer, away from Flexi. There's the deceit. There's the counter. Perfectly timed from Fatal. Perfect reads. Fatal knew exactly when Ethelwulf was going to come in there. Because Ethelwulf could come in considerably sooner than they did. And, oh, is this going to be a comeback? I think it might be. Fatal turning that whole situation around. The ultimate working out perfectly. And now just putting all the pressure onto Fatal. I'm sorry, onto Pharos and Ethelwulf. And here's the Venom Wind. Managing to infest away from that and heal away part of it and infest the rest. So Flexi and Fatal taking no damage from the Venom Wind. Ethelwulf managing to get the orb, but it's just about everything they need to survive at this point. I mean, any little mistake they make, they're going to lose one of their teammates and or one of their team members. And if that happens, it could very easily spell the end of the match for them. Some poking is coming out, though. Not a whole lot. It's still very difficult to get that poking down, but it is something at least. Actually, it's quite a bit. At this point, Ethelwulf going for another Venom Wind, missing completely. I'm not going to complain too much. They are going for Deceits. That is the correct thing to do. But still, this is proving extremely difficult. Mind you, it's also proving mildly annoying for Fatal and Flexi. They have center control. They've just got to play it patient, but the thing is, it's difficult to work with. Now, the problem for, mostly for Ethelwulf, is that they can't ultimate at this point without flying into the fog. Pharos is okay for that. Pharos might be able to save them out of that, actually, by using time travel. Time travel onto Fatal, as it were. Going for a bit of a combo, but no, Ethelwulf jumping away from that, not even trying to finish off Fatal from there. There's the seat, and there's the camouflage stun follow-up. Dealing a bit of damage, just poking away, but that's the team that is not looking to poke away. The team looking to poke away is the one now getting torn to shreds. Pharos count. Oh, okay, Wujuing Fatal into the fog, but that Wuju was Fatal for Pharos as Fatal was able to just hit them from behind. Very entertaining first round, though. Bit of a long one, but definitely entertaining. And Fatal, wow, you turned that around. They really turned that around. I'm impressed. Because for a little while, those Fatal just seemed focused down to the point that I didn't know if they would survive that, especially after they got Wujud way out of position and then stuck in the center with Flexi nowhere to be found. But it seemed like it works out ultimately. So Fatal at this point, yeah. Haven't seen them before, but I'm impressed. Flexi also kept themselves alive, which is always the thing you need to do as Pestilus. Did healing, did some damage. It's definitely good, but yeah. Good job, Fatal. Good job at basically turning that whole match around and dealing all the damage. That full ultimate was the big thing. That's really hard to do. Or really hard to have work out, and especially with the opponent team dealing with it. Like, they were avoiding that as best as possible. And now, at this point, we have Ethelwulf focused down a fair bit, and another Wuju taken out of position forcing Fatal basically into a fight with Pharos. That's the upshot of it. Fatal slightly out of position. Actually, considerably out of position. Slightly rooted as well. And Flexi does have Panic on their Queen, so if anything does hit them... Well, not hit the Queen. If the Queen dies because of Flexi's doing, then yeah, it'll work. But yeah, Flexi is going to be basically going... Yeah, there's the Panic from the Queen. I was going to say, it's going to be going for that as much as they can. It's difficult to do. Because when you are dealing with that queen, your opponent can kill it. They can just deal with it however they like. Queens are a very prime target, especially when they have the panic right. But just in general, because of the healing they provide, you want to get rid of your opponent's queen if possible. It's just, obviously, a good Pestilence player won't let that happen if they can help it. Otherwise, that would be a bad thing. Oh, did Fatal? I think Fatal intentionally did that. I think that was actually Fatal going, oh, hey, there's a Chronoflux. I'll just Wooju my way into position. Knocking Pharos away from the comfortable position. Quite a risk there, but yeah, I'm noticing Fatal. Looks like they're doing a lot of these Wujus. It almost seemed like intentional repositionings. I find that interesting because Pharos kind of wants that to an extent, because if Fatal's out of position, then, I mean, that's easier to fight, but the Chronoflux is working against Pharos in this respect because Fatal seems to be only doing it when they want to. They don't seem to be doing it that much by accident. And, oh, that is beautiful. Camouflage stun getting essentially nullified by the Queen Panic. And that's just perfect. And the reform to get rid of Venom Wind. So at this point, Fatal taking no damage from the Venom Wind. I'm not entirely sure why Ethelwolf keeps doing it, at least when they don't have Camouflage available. Like, doing Venom Wind with Camouflage available is great, because you just get the damage. Doing Venom Wind without Camouflage available, or Deceit and Deceit entirely, if you have 125 energy, but I don't think you can get that with... Certainly not in round two. I don't think you can get that with a Croak, but yeah. Kind of work out with the Orb, maybe it'll work, but at this point, doesn't matter. Pharos and Ethelwolf taking loads of damage. Pharos down, Ethelwolf, if they might be able to pull this out. They have the energy, there's the Camouflage, not a Deceit though, and unfortunately for them, not enough. They really need to focus down Flexi though, that is the big thing. Or focus down Fatal, pick one. We've seen this can work either way. Like, you can focus one or the other and it'll work. Actually, that was Serious Fire-ish, but still. It can work. I mean, Fatal doesn't have the shield right, so they can't just blow away Ethelwolf when Ethelwolf comes close. They only have the counter. Now, granted, Fatal has completely gotten Ethelwolf's number as far as counter timings go, so it's a bit harder for Ethelwolf to actually deal the meaningful damage, but Fatal is able to still do quite a lot less than the Varish we saw earlier. Because they don't have a shield. Or they don't have the shield burst. Which is always handy. But yeah, as far as Venom Wind goes, you kind of need to stun them out. If they have any escapes, you need to stun them out. And these... So it's either bait out all their escapes or stun them afterwards. Those are kind of your choices. Otherwise, just keep your energy for Deceit. Or maybe for Sludge Spit, but generally for Deceit. I don't see people use Sludge Spit a whole lot. Anyway, it looks like first orb is going to go to the blue team. Oh, no! Nice steal from Fatal! Taking that center orb as, at this point, Pharos and Ethelwolf already getting a bit of a health disadvantage right out of the gate. So, not a huge one, though. Not a huge one. They can heal this up. No permanent health has been lost yet from either side. At this point, Fatal going for the ultimate. Not able to do much with it, sadly. But once again, the Wooju to basically force a 1v1 with Pharos. Bit of a tricky position, but... Totally paying off. Fatal is wanting Pharos dead. Didn't quite manage to set up a counter, though. Looks like they wanted to Wooju past that Chronoflux, which, if they had, would have possibly killed Pharos at this point. And there's the Infest to get away from the Venom Wind, because, I mean, it's a Pestilence. You haven't baited out their Infest. They're going to Infest something. They can easily outlast the Venom Wind. Infest lasts forever compared to Venom Wind. At this point, though, it looks like Pharos and Ethelwolf actually have a bit more... going for them. They're playing a bit more of a safe pokey style than they was. Well, they did in the first round, but that was the first one when they had like 20 health each. Now they're playing it with about half health each. Bit of a safer setup, and now they're focusing on Flexi, the queen going out there to try to cause the panic. Not quite enough, though. The orb going to Pharos and Ethelwolf again. So they have that, and there's that. Ooh, missing the Arachnophobia. So at this point, there is still one panic option, but the queen being moved out of position. If it was kept in position, it might have actually kept Flexi alive there, but sadly for Flexi, it did not work. 2v1 in favor of Pharos and Ethelwolf now, I mean, Fatal, I wouldn't count them out by any means, but it is always tricky to do a 1v2. Counters down, the Wooja's down, Reform's down. There's no outs. There's no way that Fatal can avoid this, and there's the kill. Venomwind finally being used when it is going to be effective, exploding and dealing its damage, giving Pharos and Ethelwulf a point on the board. So, onto the fourth round, which is the round that Veresh always gets scary in, because they can use... they have synergy. They can get all their corruption and judgment happening all at the same time from one or the other. Although, admittedly, they have judgment bouncing, so yeah, they can easily get judgment bounced onto both of their opponents and then just hand of corruption all day and get the damage bonus and get the silence eventually. It's a lot of things Fatal can do right now. Pharos and Ethelwulf, on the other hand, they might have momentum, though. They've gotten a better idea of how to deal with this team. They know that as long as they're focusing down relatively intelligently and don't stay in too far. I mean, Fatal is extremely aggressive. Ethelwulf kind of needs to stay near Pharos a little bit just to keep Pharos from getting too focused down. Because Fatal wants Pharos's head. Or at least has wanted Pharos's head. Fatal might play a bit more cautiously after losing that last round, though. On the other hand, Flexia has always been playing cautiously. And there's the attempt at the Judgment. Oh, missing three hands of Judgment in a row is not ideal. Very good dodging coming in. Okay, the dodging coming in from Pharos and Ethelwulf. Not enough, but the focus coming in from Pharos and Ethelwulf is massive on Flexi. Did manage to hold the orb for the red team, though. Flexi's infest. They're reducing the damage dealt to the orb. But Flexi themselves needs damage reduction to themselves because they're now gone. And once again, Fatal in a 1v2 situation. A far harder situation than last time. I mean, both opponents have full health, and Fatal not even going to fight it. Just wants to go to round 5. Figures, whatever. We have another round. We can just do this. Don't want to use too much energy here. Wow, Pharos and Ethelwulf. Figure, just focus Pestilus. Like I said, that's kind of the thing kind of the consensus, as far as I've noticed. And my own experience, too. If the Pestilus isn't great at self-peel, then, yeah, focus Pestilus. Because their peel options... I mean, they have Infest as getting away, but for actual peel, I mean, they are... just for zoning in general. The Queen with Panic is good, but difficult to set up, because you have to throw down the Queen, and then you either have to wait, or you have to throw down... You have to hit it with the... I can't remember the name offhand. But you have to hit with secondary attack, and that just becomes... And that's just 30 health... on Flex, or 15 health down for Flexi themselves. So they're taking damage to try to cause panic, get out of the way. And of course they have Arachnophobia, but Arachnophobia is a lobbing attack, so it's harder to hit with. It's not going to hit along the way. It has a very specific timing as a result. It's not like, say, Panic Flask, where it can hit anywhere along its line. It hits at that point after a set period of time. So your opponent can more easily avoid it than they could, say, Panic Flask. Or even the Queen. At any rate, nice dodge, forcing Pharos' Shifting Sands out, which is something. And again, Fatal not quite pulling off that Wooju bait, the forced Wooju there. Managing to get a little bit of damage. There's the Wooju shot. Just needed to get the right positioning for it. Bit behind Pharos, forcing the healing to go away, but at this point it doesn't matter. Again, Flexi taking all the damage, finally getting saved somewhat by their teammate. Pharos, however, is also taking a lot of damage, and there's the Wooju to deal with Pharos. And Pharos with no exits, no outs at all. This is going to become a very quick 1v1. Fatal is going to be going for that. Where's the reform? No, just going. Okay, there's the reform. No, interesting. Going instead for Ethelwulf, not going for Pharos at all. There's Pharos. There's the shot on Pharos. There's the Wooju. I mean, Fatal has been doing that so often, it's brilliant. So any Varish players out there fighting against Older. Risky option, but it can work. And again, I mean, at this point, it's becoming a little bit predictable. I think Pharos might actually start setting up Chronofluxes as a setup to try to bait Fatal into attacking them. And, ooh, tried to go for it, but didn't quite work out. Actually getting too close to Ethelwulf, and Ethelwulf able to finish that off as Fatal gets a Wooju into Ethelwulf, not into Pharos as they had hoped. Didn't quite manage to get the Hand of Corruption to bounce back on them in time. But still, very... interesting strategy. I've never actually seen a Varish do that. Mind you, I don't often see a lot of Varishes, because Varish isn't a particularly popular hero in tournaments, but that's interesting. hopefully this Saturday we see some Varishes and PRL and we actually see them use stuff like that. It's a tricky strategy. It only works in this one matchup. Or actually, it would also work against Bakko, because Bulwark would also be a thing. Yeah, in both cases, it works well, as long as you can get close. The problem with Bakko, of course, is Bakko is much better at dealing with close-range combat. Older is good at combat. Older is fairly damaging. That was why I was a little unsure at first. It seemed risky, but Fatal was able to pull it off. They were able to very easily chase down Pharos and make it work. I mean, ultimately, no. Ultimately, it didn't really help, because Pharos did win. I mean, there's no denying that. Pharos and Ethelwolf did manage to win that match. But yeah, overall, a lot of that felt like it came down to a few misses, a few very careful little shots there, and some tricky strategies that I'm glad to have seen. Certainly an interesting takeaway from this stream, from this cast. Varish can do some really tricky things. Really bizarrely tricky things. So anyway, that is going to be it for me tonight. So once again, if you guys want me to cast your replays, just let me know that you have them on the Odium. That's really it. Tell me you have them on the Odium. If they have a specific name, I'll probably notice because they'll be like 10 minutes long rather than the normal like 45 second clip. So yeah, as long as I know your in-game name, I can find them and then I can cast them. So that'd be awesome. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. And once again, I will actually be also casting for the Pro Rivalry League tournament this Saturday at about... See, my shift will start somewhere around 5, but it starts at 4. PST. 4 PST, 7 EST, midnight in Europe, sorry. And if you're in Australia, you'll be waking up to it, 8 a.m. Or maybe 7 a.m., depends on which part of Australia. Anyhow, that will be the next time I do Battle Royale, but for now, I'm signing off. So I hope you enjoyed that, and thank you for watching. Have a good night, everyone.